As with every week on this show, or at least most weeks on this show, we got a little thing called Press Play.
Press Play! Hey, my favorite segment of the show.
Another one.
This is
another they. Is that what you, another they? Is they, that what you're talking about? They, the
yeah,
other one?
He says, it? Yeah, he's almost like, stay away from they. Don't let they.
Never heard it.
Yeah. Anyway, that's a DJ Khaled. I can't do it with his same enthusiasm. We have a really interesting press play, and I think the story around this particular one is interesting. So I fell asleep on this movie last night. We rewatched
it. He didn't mean he didn't like, it's not like you just, oh, you thought it was weak in terms of not watching it, and then you were like, oh, no, it's a great movie. No, you literally.
I literally fell asleep on this movie last night. So we were going to do this press play segment thinking that I was only going to be able to speak to half of this film. But we watched it, the end of the movie, this morning here at Harv Studios. So we're going to be able to have a pretty in-depth conversation about this movie. My opinions on the film have since changed.
Interesting. Okay. So first of all, let me give you the synopsis of the film. Full of misgivings, a young woman travels. First of all, I think we should probably give the name of the movie.
Yeah, why don't
I'm
do
thinking
that?
Of Ending Things is the name of this film that we're talking about. Full of misgivings, a young woman travels with her new boyfriend to his parents' secluded farm. Upon arriving, she comes to question everything she thought she knew about him and herself. This film is directed by Charlie Kaufman and written by Kaufman, as well as Iain Reid. I believe that's how you pronounce his name, who actually wrote the book for that the film is based off of. Let's not mince any words. Let's jump into what we thought about the actual plot of the movie.
So I'm going to be very honest here.
That was no I'm up for a good ring quote.
When he says, understand the plot of this film until the last 10 minutes of the film.
Yeah.
And even then I had like maybe like two or three understandings of it, and I was trying to determine or decide for myself which one made the most sense. Yeah. But as you're going through the movie, I was able to follow and you're able to track, right? But you do so not really understanding what's going on. So you get introduced at the beginning of this film, again, this young couple, they're embarking on this kind of like road trip out to see or to meet this gentleman's parents. Along the road trip, they enter kind of a snowstorm. So they get into some really bad weather. You feel the mood and the tone of the film kind of shift. One of the things I thought was most interesting is like when he first picks her up, she has on like a bright red coat and like a yellow hat and scarf, and as they're going further into this road trip and they start having like this like weird, deeper, darker conversation, her outfit changes.
Yeah.
And then she has on the blue jacket and so on and so on. So I thought like little things like that were interesting, mm-hmm. but it also made you lose track of like time and where you were and like kind of what's happening. But anyway, so they get to his parents' house, they're having these like really weird, uncomfortable conversations. Time keeps shifting throughout the film. At one point the parents are old, at one point they're young. The house seems to operate in a different field of time as well. That's kind of all of those things kind of lose me. And then what this film does well is it kind of ties it back up at the end for you.
Yeah.
So you can enjoy this film while being lost at certain points. And then towards the end, it makes sense.
Yeah. I think that's what was, really interesting, because I had read the book, which is why I was kind of excited to watch the movie. I think that there's really stark differences between the book and the movie, which make it infinitely harder to understand what the fuck is going on in the movie. As they're heading to his parents' place, the conversation that they have is a very sort of strange conversation, right? And Addy, got to give a shout out to you because you kind of took the words out of my mouth, but you said this earlier today, but they are essentially like finishing each other's sentences. They're like, it's just like, it's like almost like one person talking, mm-hmm. but with how rapid the conversation and the editing is being done. And so maybe I guess I could talk about that when we talk about the cinematography, but, it just leaves you in a very sort of strange place. And then you arrive at the parents' house and things are even stranger there, of just the communications and also like the sort of the weirdness of time. And so you're left with not understanding exactly like where you are. And shout out to Jesse Plemons and Jesse Buckley, who play Jake, as well as I guess what would be called young woman, because her name is said like many times, but it always changes, right? You go from calling her Lucy to calling her, I think it's like Yvonne or something like that. Is at one point we call her
Louise
or something like that, some shit.
And then at a certain point he even calls her like
Amy
or something along those lines.
Or yeah, Ames or some shit. And so, so you're left with this sort of like surrealist, like what the fuck is happening here? Sort of vibe from the movie. So one of the stark differences between the book and the movie, and this obviously happens in a lot of adaptations, is obviously you're not able to get into a person's mind. Obviously we actually go through her, this young woman's mind, because she's sort of narrating. But early on in both the book as well as the movie, you start to learn that she's a really unreliable narrator, that mm-hmm. she's sort of narrating the movie or the movie for you. But, you know, for one, he keeps interrupting her. Like, that's one thing I noticed a lot, that he interrupts her thoughts.
Yeah.
And it's almost like, and he's almost like reacting to her thoughts, that he seems agitated because she's thinking something that mm-hmm. he's just like irritated by. So I thought all that was really interesting. And so you start to, as they get to the farm, you start to understand, okay, that they haven't been together too long. They tell the story of how they first met,
like 6 weeks
parents,
or so,
6 weeks. But then there's like facts that are missing from there that they both are kind of like, mm-hmm. what's, you know, neither of us really knows what's going on there. And then they just kind of move on. And then when we get to the house, then this, what you're talking about, as far as like issues with time, like, you know, their parents go from being middle-aged to being really old to being really young.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of imagery that's put in here. One of the most sort of like, I guess, apparent is, so the woman sees a picture on the wall, and the picture to her looks like her, you know? But, you know, Jake is basically like, no, that's me. She's like, no, that's definitely me. Well, but why would I be in this picture?
Yeah.
And so things start to like unravel from that case. But then also another thing that kind of hints to sort of the big reveal of the movie, even though it wasn't necessarily revealed flat out, was how they kind of flip intelligence. And I don't know if you caught that, where it goes from, she's telling the story of how they first met, right? And she can't even remember some of the words that he used, right? Or that she's remembering that he used when they first met, that she's struggling to like really like interpret the words, understand what they mean, yada yada, to at scenes when now they're in the car, back in the car as they're leaving his parents' place. And now she's, you know, basically, and I forget exactly what she was talking about. I think she was like quoting something about physics, I want to say, because mm-hmm. And then also that's another weird thing too, that she goes from being like an artist to she's studying physics.
Yeah.
She's a poet. Like poet, yeah. You know, and so all these different things. And all of it is leading you to understand, you know, we might as well, since we're running out of time, to kind of get to the point, but to understand that, we're essentially watching this guy, Jake, as he's either dying or has died. But we're sort of each one of the characters outside of maybe, I think perhaps his parents, are essentially representations of him,
yeah.
of things that he's remembering from his past. And so that was the big reveal of the movie. It was a little hard to parse through if you're not familiar with the book, because in the book, they're way more explicit with that point, that you get to the end and it tells you basically
the ending is a little bit more like defined.
Than the film. It's a little harder to pick out in the film, but you were even able to get to at least most of it before we, you know, told you exactly sort of what was going on. And so I thought that was all really interesting, an interesting way to sort of put it all together. I think that my issue with both cases is that they kind of, in a weird way, and I guess maybe this is the big conversation that's happening around the book, is that they kind of romanticize suicide. It's mm-hmm. essentially sort of like what the issue is with both. I think that they kind of do in a lot of different ways.
Things feel so like serene and peaceful. Like, oh, it'll be so much easier.
I mean, it wasn't serene or peaceful, but it was, they try to make it poetic.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's sometimes like, where's the line, right? Between making something, because when things are poetic, it becomes things that you're trying to like, is okay to like mimic, or it's okay to like, oh man, I want to be, you know, poetic, and I want to be, you know, it's beautiful in a way, and you know, but truth is, it's not, it's ugly, it's dark, it's fucked up.
Yeah.
And I don't think that this film nor the book really sort of like, I guess it's all dark, mm-hmm. but I don't, it does it in this really sort of artistic way, which kind of detracts from the fact that it's a dark, really from dark, like
the
thing.
Harsh reality. I mean,
like the movie thing. Itself is kind of dark. The book itself was kind of dark, but it's all done in this really poetic way, which kind of takes away from that, I think, underlying thought. But in any case, let's try to breeze through the rest of these real quick. I know you're very limited on time. So let's talk about the characters real quick. Who's your MVP? Who's your runner up?
So my runner-ups, I'm going to give two runner-ups, and my MVP, I'm going to have to like make just a quick decision there. So Toni Collette, who plays Mother, I thought she did a phenomenal job just making you, like, you felt their relationship, like this like kind of like a strange mother and son relationship. She made you uncomfortable. She was unsettling. At certain points, she seemed like a charming, loving mother. And it was that dinner conversation that made it difficult for me to like understand what's going on. Like, is it him? Is it her? Is it them? And I thought it was because of the performance that both parents had. Yep. So she's one of my runner ups. Honestly, I know this is going to sound weird because he did such a stellar job in this film. Jesse Plemons is also one of my runner ups.
Mm-hmm.
His performance was stellar, but I think there are two people in my opinion who like really shine for me.
Mm-hmm.
So my MVP two is going to be David. I don't know what the fuck. David Thewlis, who plays father. I thought that he, for me, at a certain point in the film, I'm thinking like he has like a bigger role in all of this, like because he seemed put together, but also just a little bit crazy. He seemed like he knew what was going on a little bit more than everybody else. He was charming. He was funny. He seemed like he was less crazy than everyone else. And at a certain point, I started wondering, like, all right, does this film kind of, you know, revolve around him at a certain point? And I think it was because of the way he played this character and conveyed this character and all of the things, all the nuances of this character that, for me, that really stood out. Like, I kept thinking back to the father in this movie. Like, what role did he play in all of this?
Yeah.
And then my MVP one is going to be Jessie Buckley, who plays young woman. You like her from the beginning, and you root for her throughout this entire movie. You see her character go through all of these, you know, changes in either like her mental state, her changes in, you're following changes in her outfit. You're worried about her. You're scared for her. You want her to win. You think at a certain point she might be the villain, and she does all of that in, you know, a matter of 2 hours in this character. So I thought she did a stellar job. She's my MVP.
I'll make this quick. So my runner up is Jessie Buckley as well. I thought she was fantastic in the film. I thought she was, she had a weird task to take, in that she was both, again, like the narrator of the film, but also she wasn't the narrator of the film.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a very interesting, because at times she was like, we're seeing the story through her lens, right? Mm-hmm. Then other times, definitely not. And so I thought that was a hard thing to try to capture. And I thought she did it really well. I think, you know, and maybe this is just remnants of watching Hereditary, but I thought Toni Collette, just anytime I see her on screen, I am both in awe of her in terms of just like, holy shit, she's such a great actress, and also scared the shit of her. I don't know like what it is about her, but she just, when she was just incessantly laughing, it's creepy as fuck. All right. But she pulls it off well. You know, given the descriptions that they had in the book, she was like, to a T, she sort of hit all the marks as far as that goes. So she gets my MVP vote because she's just I think she's just amazing. And by the way, the casting by credit on this film is Rory Bergman, as well as Jenny McCarthy. although I don't think it's that Jenny McCarthy. Let's talk super quick about the cinematography, which the cinematographer of the film was Lucas Zal. So a couple of things that I took away from the film, cinematography wise, is that they kind of they told the story through the cinematography, really. That, okay, so take for instance, like when they were in a car, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of the times when they would show you the conversation that was happening between Jake as well as this woman who, for argument's sake, let's call her Lucy, since that's the first name that we call her. You're seeing it from his perspective, in that the camera angle stays on his side of the car, but just kind of drifts over to her. Which is, it's basically signaling to us that, oh, like, she is him, you know? And they do that so many different ways that it's almost like, you know, I can't even list how many ways that they just use the way that they shot it to tell you what they're trying to tell you without telling you directly.
Yeah.
And I thought that they did that beautifully throughout the film.
And I agree with that. And one of the things that I think they did well on top of that is, like, they didn't use, like, what, you know, a standard angle for the camera. It was like they were shooting him directly outside of the driver's side window. They weren't shooting directly into the windshield. It was like these kind of like these like low angles that were, like, you didn't get a great shot of him, you didn't get a great shot of her.
Yeah,
they were still like very intimate. Combined, like, yeah. You know, like, it kind of created this like unsettling conversation between two people, which, you know, may have just been one person.
Yeah.
So I thought both the way they shot it and the angles that they used made for like a really like unique kind of like environment or tone to the whole thing.
Yeah. And then just another little minute way that they kind of pull that off was if you notice, like, the dad doesn't ever look at him.
Mm.
The dad just looks at her, which I don't know. I don't know exactly. Obviously, we know what they were trying to communicate, but knowing that on the backside is way easier to sort of suss that out.
Yeah.
But yeah, I noticed the entire time that the dad literally doesn't look at him the whole time, like even as he's holding him, because I think he has to help him up at one point. He still doesn't look at Jake. He only looks at again, like what we call Lucy. So let's move on to the score of the film, which we don't have to spend much time on. The music by credit on this is Jay Wadley. The score of the film, I thought that we didn't really get too much of a score until we go to some of the until the illusion is starting to break, mm-hmm. until we start to understand exactly what's going on, that they really just use a lot of like the natural sounds of the environment in order to kind of make it sort of, I guess, just a lot more creepier and just a lot more intentional. But I didn't really start to notice the score until we start getting towards the school.
Exactly.
And things like that. So just a couple of extra notes on this movie. For one, I'll say Charlie Kaufman clearly was the perfect person to direct this movie. I don't know if he sought the story out or if they sought him out to direct it, but clearly he's the perfect person to do this. And I say that because of his history, right? That he directed Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, mm-hmm. Which I'll talk about in a sec. But then he also was one of the producers on Being John Malkovich. So all these movies are just weird fucking movies, right? That are really offbeat. Yeah, offbeat movies. Eternal Sunshine. And this movie is basically Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind without with the characters all being the same person, essentially, because it plays with time and it plays with going backwards and forwards in time and things like that. But it does it all through the perspective of like a person having other people play the same role, but or play him. So we press play on the movie. I'm thinking about ending things, and we hope you guys did as well. Let us know what the fuck you thought about the movie below. Give us your understanding of it, as well as just how you felt about the movie overall. How did you feel about the book? Did you like the sort of the how they portrayed the book, or didn't you like, you know, how they did things from the book?
Most interestingly enough, like, if you've done one or the other, if you did it in reverse, if you read the book and saw the movie, or saw the movie then went back and read the book, I think those perspectives are like really interesting. So I would really want to hear from those people. If you've done one in reverse, share with us your thoughts on like what you think of seeing the book or reading the book first versus the movie, or watching the movie then the book. I feel like you'd have two very different perspectives.
Yeah, absolutely.